The Lord be with you. Welcome to worship this day and a blessed Father's Day to those for whom it applies, to fathers and grandfathers, great-grandfathers, uncles, those who serve in a fatherly role. We want to make sure there are many ways that fatherhood is acknowledged in our world today. We give thanks. I don't have really any other announcements to make today. We are, as you see, we're in the season of the green again, the green season of learning what it means to be the church and what it means to be disciples of Jesus. And today we will hear, I'm going to be discussing in my sermon the word chaos and what, when chaos comes to our lives, where do we find God and what does God teach us in chaos through the work of the book of, looking at the book of Job and also the gospel of Mark, where Jesus is sleeping in a boat with his disciples who weren't very happy about that. So we'll learn about that today. Our order of service is a simplified version of the service of the Word, and it's printed in your bulletin. I invite us to do, as we always do every week, we gather at the font of our baptism to confess our sins and to hear the promise of forgiveness in Christ. I ask you to please rise. I also need to say as well that the flowers on the altar this morning are given in memory of Bert Stober by his family. We thanks for that. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of this world. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? You have the words of eternal life. Lord, have mercy on us. Amen. Beloved people of God, through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown mercy and receive life abundant. Therefore, as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Jesus Christ, and by his authority, I announce to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We will listen together to our gathering hymn, Eternal Father, Strong to Save. Please be seated. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We speak together the prayer of the day printed in your bulletin. O God of creation, eternal majesty, you preside over land and sea, sunshine and storm. By your strength, pilot us. By your power, preserve us. By your wisdom, instruct us. And by your hand, protect us. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the readings. The first reading this morning is from the book of Job, and this will serve as one of the texts for my sermon this morning. The Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind, "Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? Or what were its bases? Or what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy? Or who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band, and prescribed bounds for it and set bars and doors and said, thus far shall you come and no farther, and here shall your proud waves be stopped. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." Our psalm today is Psalm 107. And we will read the psalm responsively. Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good, for God's mercy endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord proclaim that God redeemed them from the hand of the foe, gathering them in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Some went down to the sea in ships, plying their trade in deep waters. They beheld the works of the Lord, God's wonderful works in the deep. Then God spoke, and a stormy wind arose, which tossed high the waves of the sea. They mounted up to the heavens and descended to the depths. Their souls melted away in their peril. They staggered and reeled like drunkards, and all their skill was of no avail. Then in their trouble they cried to the Lord, and you delivered them from their distress. You stilled the storm to a whisper, and silenced the waves of the sea. Then were they glad when it grew calm, when you guided them to the harbor they desired. Let them give thanks to you, Lord, for your steadfast love and your wonderful works for all people. Let them exalt you in the assembly of the people. In the council of the elders, let them sing hallelujah. Our second reading is from the second letter of Corinthians, chapter 6. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We're putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way, through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in all repute and good repute, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet are well known, as dying and see we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. We've spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open to you. There is no restriction in our affections, but only in yours. In return, I speak as to children. Open wide are your hearts also. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We hear our next hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near, and the day is past and gone, at the precious Lord, lead me home.
Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel for today is for the fourth Sunday of Pentecost. Excuse me. The Holy Gospel for the fourth Sunday of Pentecost is taken from Mark chapter 4. Glory to you, O Lord. On that day when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him, and a great gale arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And then the wind ceased and there was a dead calm. And he said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. As I mentioned in my announcements, this morning we're going to consider one of the most frightening words of all, and that is the word chaos. That's not a word we like to hear. To live in chaos means that your world is out of control. Chaos means that no one is in charge anymore. Chaos means that everyone for themselves. Chaos means our future is insecure and unknown. Chaos is a terrifying word. The main question for today is this: where is God in the middle of chaos? Because chaos comes to our lives whether we want it or not. Where is God in the middle of chaos, and what does God do about it? And our search for an answer will take us to two places in Scripture this morning. Our first stop will be in our Old Testament reading from the book of Job. And whenever you speak or preach about the book of Job, we have to always do a little bit of a review of the story, because the story sets the stage for what is said. If you remember the story of Job, Job is, the book says, blameless before God. He's a faithful worshiper and a devout follower of God. However, God decides to test Job's faith by allowing Satan to tear his life apart in a matter of a few hours. Satan makes a deal with God that if Job's blessings are taken from him, then he will curse God and die. And so in the course of a few days, chaos comes to Job. He loses most of his family, all of his possessions and property. and is inflicted with the most terrible diseases. Chaos has come. And as the story, as the book begins, Job is sitting in the dust with his clothes ripped apart, crying out to God, crying and complaining and weeping, but he will not curse God and die. And most of the book of Job consists of speeches and a conversation between Job and his three friends, because these three friends have heard what has happened to Job and they come to give their opinion and advice. The big question, of course, is why did God allow this to happen to Job? And they all agree that the only reason possible, the only possible answer must be that Job is being punished, that it's Job's fault, that he must have done something terrible for God to allow this to happen. And so from chapter after chapter after chapter in the book, we have this conversation between Job and his friends. And over they repeat themselves saying, Job, it's your fault. You have to dig a little harder. You have to think a little more. You have to figure out what it is. And every time Job's answer is, I haven't done a thing. I don't know what I've done. I have not sinned. I can't remember. I don't know. I haven't done it. I am blameless. And the back and forth continues throughout most of the book until we get to the very end. And we're waiting because we know that eventually God is going to speak. And we wait. Job's life is in chaos. He doesn't know why, but he knows that he is not the cause. And as the story comes near the end, Job is sitting and waiting, along with his friends, waiting for God to speak, waiting for God to explain, waiting for God to give him the answer he needs. Why? Why this chaos, God? Why? Where are you? Why? And finally, after all the speeches are done, it is God's turn to speak, which brings us to the reading we have in our lessons this morning from Job. God speaks, and here's what God says. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. I like Eugene Peterson's paraphrase of this in his book, The Message. Here's how he rewrites what God says. And God answered, why do you confuse the issue? Why do you talk without knowing what you're talking about? Pull yourself together, Job. Up on your feet. Stand tall, because I have some questions for you. And I want some straight answers. Where were you when I created the earth? Tell me, since you know so much. Not a lot of sympathy or tenderness from God today, is there? See, God will not explain. God will not answer Job's questions. Instead, God simply says this, Job, I am God and you are not. I created all that is. I created you and I created everything you see and everything you don't see. I have all wisdom and knowledge and you do not. God does not defend himself or explain the reasons behind Job's chaos. And yet, it's important, we must remember that where is God? God is with Job. God is present with Job. God hears Job. God stays with Job. And as the story ends, it so happens, God does restore Job's wealth and his home and gives him a new family and a fresh start. This is how the story of Job ends. It's not very satisfying, if you're looking for explanations, to read the book of Job. If you want answers to all of your questions about chaos and suffering, if you're asking why today in our lives, the book of Job does not deliver the answers we want. But what the book of Job does say is this: God is bigger and God is beyond all the darkness, bigger and beyond the unexplainable in your life. And God does not explain the chaos, Job. God says, Job, I am with you. I have not forgotten you. In the middle of the chaos, I am here, and you belong to me. God doesn't explain, but God is with us. So that's our first scripture stop this morning. And now I'd like us to move to our gospel reading in Mark. Jesus is sleeping in a boat with his disciples on the Sea of Galilee when suddenly a terrifying storm rises up. Once again, chaos has come. Chaos comes in the form of a violent storm on the sea. And this is no simple thunderstorm, because the boat was sinking. The disciples know that if this keeps up, if nothing is done, they will drown. And their life and their world is ending. Chaos has come to them, and in the middle of all this chaos, they notice that Jesus is sleeping. As their world is falling apart, as their life is about to end, Jesus is sleeping. And just like Job, they have a question. Just like Job, they have a question for their Lord. They say, "Lord, don't you care that we are perishing? Don't you care?" After Jesus commands the chaos to end, he wakes up and the winds cease, and Jesus, though, isn't done. He challenges his disciples with these words, and he sounds like a lot like the God of Job, doesn't he, today? He says, "Why are you afraid? Have you no faith?" In other words, "I'm here. Can't you see that? I always was here. In the chaos, I am here. And the winds and the waves and all that is, including you, disciples, belong to me." Speaking of chaos, we have one more stop to make this morning. We must travel to a very dark place. And this place is where we really behold the greatest chaos of all. We journey to that hill outside of Jerusalem called Golgotha. We travel to the cross together. On the cross, chaos has come. The ultimate and the final chaos. Because on this cross, we see the very Holy Son of God himself, bruised and broken, nailed to the wood between two criminals. He has been innocently convicted, betrayed by his friends, abandoned by everyone else. The world's darkness led him there, and our sin nailed and tied him there. The world is upside down. Chaos has come, and the chaos of the cross, just like Job and just like the disciples in that sinking boat, here on this awful hill called Calvary, even Jesus cries out, "Why? My God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus is on the cross. Now Jesus is where Job was. Jesus is where the disciples were. In the chaos of the cross, Jesus cries out to the Father. He asks the heartbreaking question, "Where are you, God? My God, why have you forsaken me?" It's the same question Job asks, and it's the same question the drowning disciples ask. And isn't this the question that you and I ask when chaos overwhelms us like crashing waves and threatens to swallow us whole? My God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus cries. And on this day, God does not answer. God does not explain. Jesus dies without an explanation or an answer. Jesus is buried. And then the waiting begins, the waiting for God to speak. The cross is unexplainable. The cross is the world as we know it turned upside down. Because here, the only sinless, perfect man who ever lived, who is indeed God, bears the torment and chaos of our sin, while we who deserve to be nailed there stand back and watch. On this cross, Jesus does what we cannot do. He carries all of our fears, all of our sin, all of our terrors, all of our betrayal, all that binds, all that has broken us. He takes it all on his back, on his heart, and it breaks for us. He carries our chaos and the chaos of the whole world to the cross with him. The cross is the world falling apart. The cross is darkness triumphing. The cross is the victory of death and the devil. The cross is the end. All is lost. Chaos has won. And then comes the third day. And finally, on the third day, God speaks. Out of the chaos, God speaks. The stone is rolled away, and the tomb is empty, and the angel announces to the disciples and to the world, "He is not here, he is risen." And from that empty tomb, God speaks, "He is not here, he is risen." And now we see, and now we hear, and now we know. Where were you, God? God was with Jesus. Even in the chaos, God had not forsaken. God had not walked away. God had not abandoned. No, God was with Jesus. No, more than just with Jesus, more than merely with Jesus, God acted. God raised Jesus. God entered the chaos. God transformed the chaos from death and darkness into light and life. And on the third day, a new word was born, a new world was born, resurrection, Easter, Resurrection Day. Chaos still comes to this world, brother. Chaos comes to your world, sister. In an instant, in a flash, this broken world can fall apart on you. And suddenly nothing makes sense, and all that you depend on seems to have withered away, and you question, and you doubt, and you struggle mightily with life and faith. These times are unavoidable. It is simply who we are as fallen human beings in this fallen world. And when the chaos comes to you in the middle of it all, in the darkest darkness, you can be sure that you are not alone. In the chaos, God does not explain, but God is with you. God is with you. But you know, this is not enough. We need, in the chaos, we need more than a God who merely comes to hold your hand. We need something to be done. We need a final word. We need a final word we can cling to. We need a word that says, no matter what I must live through, no matter what my earthly future holds for me, no matter what I feel or don't feel, no matter how strong or weak my faith is today, no matter how heavy the burden I carry, no matter how bleak the future looks, no matter how deep the hole, in the chaos of my life, I need a final word. What will it be? Here it is. He is not here. He is risen. Easter is always our final word. The world is broken, undependable, uncertain. This life is unpredictable and can sink us in a flash. And in the chaos, cling tightly to the final word. Because the chaos may be terrifying and cruel and overwhelming, but chaos can never have the final word. Not since that day. Not since that Easter day. Not since that resurrection day. Who will separate us from the love of God in Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Not even the chaos. God is with you. Brothers and sisters, in Christ your future is sealed. In Christ your fate is certain. In Christ your journey's end is firm. Where Christ is, you shall be. Yes, pain still endures for a time. Yes, suffering and grief lingers on. Yes, we struggle in this broken world for the time being. But chaos cannot endure. For God's word is final. He is not here. He is risen. Alleluia and amen. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We hear together the hymn, Jesus, Savior, Pilot Me.
Jesus, Savior, pilot me of a life tempestuous sea. Unknown waves before me roll, hiding rock and treacherous shoal, chart and compass from the sea. Jesus, Savior, pilot me. As a mother steals her child, thou canst hush the ocean wild. Boisterous waves obey thy will, when thou sayest to them, be still. Wondrous sovereign of the sea, Jesus, Savior, pilot me. When at last I near the shore, and the fearful breakers roll, twixt me and the peaceful rest, then while leaning on thy breast, I will pilot thee.
Please rise as we confess our faith in the risen Christ in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for the prayers. Let us pray. Holy God, you gather your people from east and west, north and south. We pray for the mission of the church throughout the world, that your steadfast love may be made known to all peoples. We remember today those Christians around the world who must pay a high price for confessing their faith, and those missionaries who take great risks to spread the gospel. Give them strength and courage as they sow the seed. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for our congregation, St. John. Pray for our pastor, our council, staff, and all who serve as volunteers. Grant us knowledge, patience, and love through our work and by your Spirit, that you may be exalted and glorified by this community and all that we say and do. Lord, in your mercy. On this World Refugee Sunday, we give you thanks for Canadian Lutheran World Relief and all who have participated over the past 75 years in giving committed and unfaltering assistance to those who seek refuge in Canada. Move us to continue the work that has begun in loving service and to meet the ever-increasing needs of this world's people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for families this day and especially for the leadership and love of fathers on this Father's Day. We also pray for those who wish to be fathers but cannot, for those with broken or strained relationships, for those who are missing their fathers today, and for fathers who have lost children. For thankful hearts, for strength, for wisdom, for peace, we pray. Lord, in your mercy. Regard the needs of your people, gracious God, and be with the sick, comfort the grieving, and company all who struggle in body, mind, or spirit, especially those whom we name before you today, Ed Friss, Elsa Penchik, and Gunter Kurt Kussling. Give us our daily bread and help us to do your will, Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for the lives of those who have died. We remember this day Lorraine Hobson and Berthold Stober. Bring comfort and courage to their families. Keep us in your loving grace now and when we join with them in the light of your eternal presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Do we have any other requests for prayer this morning? Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please rise as we join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Just a warm good morning and welcome everyone to worship today. I know you're all aware of the announcement this week about the reopening of the province. Don't have much to say today except we're going to be looking at, I think we need to hear from the AHS about worship guidelines, about how what reopening will look like, but hopefully we'll have more information for you next Sunday. So please stay alert and listen, and we will have more information for you next week. But next week it'll be business as usual, one more week for sure. So we're almost there. The end is near, and we give thanks. And we give thanks today for Michael and Laura. Michael, through this whole time, you've been a real gift to us by sharing your voice and giving us voice to these songs. So again, thank you for that continuing gift. We appreciate it very much. Any other announcements? I think we're good. We'll rise for our ascending hymn, please. Lord, take my hand and lead me.
Take my hand and lead me upon life's way. Direct, protect, and feed me from day to day. Without your grace and favor, I go astray. So take my hand, O Savior, and lead the way. Lord, when the tempest rages, I need not fear, for you, the rock of ages, are always near. Close by your side abiding, I fear no foe, for when your hand is guiding, in peace I go. But when the shadows lengthen and night has come, I know that you will strengthen my steps toward home. Then nothing can impede me, O blessed friend. So take my and